Thanks, Ryan. So first, I would like to thank all the organizers for, you know, organizing this nice workshop and giving me an opportunity to give a talk here. And you know, right now also, thanks. It's been a long week, but so I will try to be brief. If I can, and also I would like to thank all the staff at IPAM for, you know, making all the arrangements. They've been impeccable so far. Yes, so my talk will be only loosely related to the main theme of this workshop, which is mean field games. It will be maybe more related to, let's say, something like mean field control. We've seen in several talks, for instance, in the talk of Alpar on Monday, that AJB equations in spaces of probability measures are closely related to master equations of mean field games, so there is at least the connection there. So the problem will be more or less the following: that we have an AJB equation. I will specify precisely of what kind, what's the type of the equation in the space of probability measures, and then we have for these equations we have some appropriately defined viscosity solution. So there are many ways to say what a viscosity solution is, or some kind of solution for AJB equation in the space of probability measures. But so I'll be precise about this. And then we have finite dimensional AJB equations, which, let's say, they correspond to problems, optimal control problems for n particle systems, and these are equations in finite dimensional spaces, say Rd, n copies of Rd, so Rd to the power n, say when d is a dimension of some underlying space, and you know, so of course you need to start with the equation of some form, so that you can say what the equation corresponding to n particle system is. So you may start with some kind of AJB equation for which you suspect what your solution should be. It should be some value function, and then you kind of discretize it, but then you can make make this equation more general and see if one can say anything in a more general situation. We'll be trying to answer the question, you know, can we prove in some sense that the solutions of the finite dimensional AJB equations converge to this solution of the kind of limiting AJB equation, whatever it is. And if we can, can we interpret the limit? So is the U our limiting function? Is it the value function of some, you know, variational or optimal control problem, or maybe some kind of value function for some kind of a differential gain problem, or something like this, right? I mean, sometimes we'll have a candidate for this function, limiting function U. Sometimes we may know nothing about it. So this is more or less what my talk will be about, and so these are kind of classical questions and classical problems that have been around, and you know, results in this kind of directions are somehow around. You know, one may say that some facts exist in a kind of formal way. You know, if you look at lectures of Pierre-Louis and the notes of Pierre Cardin-Jagouin, there are some formal things mentioned there. And, you know, otherwise, people may say that it's kind of a, some results may be considered part of the folklore of the theory. But, you know, we just wanted to look at this problem really rigorously from the point of view of viscosity solutions. So the main points that I would like to emphasize is that, you know, we want to work with under minimal assumptions. So, you know, no smooth solutions, no regularity. So work with the viscosity solutions. So that will kind of force us with working with no regularity besides, say, continuity, uniform continuity. You know, sometimes maybe you can have better regularity. And of course, it will kind of restrict the types of equations that we are going to consider. So I say that, well, Hamiltonian must have some proper form, and also the equation, the whole equation must have some form to carry it through. So as far as the notion of viscosity solution, so we'll work with this notion of a so-called L viscosity solution, where the equation in the space of probability measures is interpreted in the lifted form on a Hilbert space. And the main kind of themes will be, well, you know, you need to pass to the limit with some functions. So of course one needs to get some kind of uniform continuity estimates for the finite dimensional problems, which will give some compactness. And this is calligraphic P2 is the space of probability measures on RD with finite second moments, the usual notation. And then, of course, we'll have to prove that these functions un, which are functions of on finite dimensional spaces, when they are converted to functions of empirical measures, and that's in the way in which this convergence will be interpreted, right? Because, you know, otherwise we have functions on two different spaces. We'll try to prove that they converge to the unique viscosity solution of the HIV equation. So this the advantage of looking at these L viscosity solutions is that you know, these are the interpretation is in a Hilbert space, and the theory on a Hilbert space is well developed. It's a nice space. It's very easy to prove that viscosity solutions are unique. But you know, things are not as rosy as we may think. So there will be some obstacles there. So first, let me just say a few words about kind of related results or known results. So some were already mentioned in this workshop, for instance, in the talk by Alpar on Monday. You know, we have the convergence problems in the context of master equations of mean field games. So I mentioned several names here, references, but you know, that type of result that has been proved is the, for instance, like the one in this big paper by Cardin-Jagouin, De La Rue, Lasry, and Lyons, that classical solutions of finite dimensional second order Nash systems converge two classical solutions of the corresponding master equations. So this was done there in, and I guess Alpar and Wilfried had also a result of this type. So this is done, you know, when assuming that that the master equation has a smooth solution, and then basically the kind of the strategy is as Alpar was explaining, that you know you look at master equation restricted to the to empirical measures, and then it satisfies some kind of a perturbed system of related to the Nash equilibrium, and then you know you use the smoothness and to try to get some kind of often even explicit rate of convergence. And then there's also a big subject on about convergence of functionals of empirical measures of marginal laws of some particle systems for Matkin-Vlasov of stochastic differential equations. So results can be many results. I'm only kind of citing here a few results that whose proofs use the PDE techniques. So there are some things in the book of Carmona and De La Rue, and there are some other papers on the subject. So one can find there's explicit convergence estimates, and they are basically the general idea is similar to the one that I just explained for the convergence of problems for these mean field games. One uses some PDE techniques, stochastic analysis. These are all results that, you know, in the kind of PDE, from the PDE point of view, only deal with linear PDEs and within the class of, there's always an assumption about there's a smooth solution. And there are many other related results, because obviously, I mean, this is a kind of very much related to the big theme of, let's say, call it propagation of chaos. So there are all kinds of big literature on results for all kinds of particle systems. There are also finite dimensional approximations of AJB equation have also been looked at from the point of view of regularity estimates. Again, in the talk of by Alpar on Monday, that was he was talking about some results of this type. So I kind of list these three papers here, but you know there is more. And then finally, since I'm talking about equations in abstract spaces, there is by now a huge literature on AJB equations and master equations for mean field games. I list several names of papers without giving explicit references, but the paper which is probably the closest that I want to single out is a recent paper by Gangbo and Tudorascu, which looked precisely at the first order IJB equations and these the space of probability measures and these L viscosity solutions. There is a lot of material, rigorous material there. I don't think there is anything about finite D approximations, but this will be using some stuff from there. Also, let me mention equations for control problems, for instance, with partial observation. That was a big classical problem of partial observation when you convert it to fully observable problem. Then this is basically the control of the Zakai equation, and then the AJB equation should be considered in the space of probability measures. And that was people studied this in Hilbert spaces. But you know, these recent papers use the new ideas related to spaces of probability measures. And there are stuff equations related to differential games. There are also equations, AJB equations, related to mostly to large deviations and fluid dynamics. So there's this kind of an approach that Jin Feng and Tom Kurtz developed about proving large deviations for empirical measures. Using the kind of viscosity techniques and PDEs in spaces of probability measures. So this is kind of a very abstract thing, but basically it tries to develop some kind of bars per term type method of relaxed limits in spaces of probability measures to deal with these large deviation problems. In large deviation problems, you have it's basically, you know, you have exponential, you need to have exponential tightness and the existence of so-called Laplace limit. And so the existence of the Laplace limit is dealt through these AJB methods, through the PDE methods. And so I just mentioned this. Also, there's the big literature now, and not big, but there's a literature on AJB equations in metric spaces that I worked on with Wilfried. Also some related literature where say for people like the papers of Goslan, Robredo, Samson, related people that were kind of using the properties of the Hopflux Olejnik formula to prove all kinds of inequalities in spaces of measures, like Lok-Sobolev inequality, which they is kind of related to some kind of hypercontractivity property for the semigroup. So there is a big literature there too. And finally, let me mention that there is really huge literature on first and second order equations in Hilbert spaces. So that began with works of Crandall and Lyons for first order equations, and then Pierre-Louis Lyons. And I worked on the second order equations, so that, you know, the literature by now is huge. If anybody is interested, then I refer to a recent book by Fabri, Gozzi, and myself, when there is a kind of an account of the existing theory, viscosity, mild solutions, weak solutions, like solutions in kind of L2 spaces, and the backward approach to with the chapter that Marco Fuhrman and Gianmario Tessitore wrote for us. So, and I'm not even mentioning some other abstract things that show up. I mean, that some other concepts that lead to a rather abstract setups, like, you know, the concepts of path-dependent viscosity solutions, etc. That Jan Fink is an expert. So enough for this introduction. So let me move to the subject. So we'll be looking at the first and second order degenerate AJB equations of this form. So this is a parabolic, kind of a time-dependent, let's say, problem of this type. And here this delta W of U is the so-called partial Laplacian of U. P2 is the space of probability measures, etc., etc. And the Hamiltonian is defined in this way. So H of mu nu and xi is this integral of hx nu xi of x nu dx. And h is some function that goes from Rd, p2 cross Rd. And the goal, as I mentioned, is to justify that the solution u of this IJB equation can be obtained as the limit of the approximating finite dimensional problems. So here, the approximating finite dimensional problems are relatively, it's kind of self-explanatory, right? How they arise. I mean, if you take mu to be empirical measure and just use some kind of relation between derivatives, you have this. And you know, I took here these averages over the measures, Dirac deltas from J is different from I, just kind of to adhere to a standard convention. I mean, there's one could just have these averages without this restriction, and then one could get rid of this F incorporated into H, but it doesn't really matter. And the AN is in the case of this partial Laplacian is should be the ND cross ND matrices that are composed of N2 block matrices, which are just identities. And as I said, the equation will be interpreted in this lifted L2 sense, which, so without loss of generality, we can take E to be L2 on omega with values in Rd, where omega is 0, 1. You can take any, basically any omega with a non-atomic measure. And then you define these lifted functions. So you define function u0, which is the this calligraphic u0 with the x push forward L1 and capital F of x the same. And so this is the initial condition. This is this kind of a function that comes from the kind of a running cost. And so this is the law of the random variable x. And when x is in L2, this is in this measure is in P2. And the partial Laplacian is the defined as the partial trace of the Wasserstein Hessian, the second order differential. So you take the canonical basis of Rd. So for this, I guess next week there will be a lecture on the explicitly on the Wasserstein Hessian based on the paper by Wilfried and I forgot the name, the Chen, I think, or Chow. And anyway, sorry about that.
It was Yatin Chow.
Chan, okay. Sorry about that. Thank you. And then, so if you consider these vectors as constant functions, then this partial Laplacian is defined in this way. And I'll later explain what this kind of is. But so wait for it. And then, but the thing is that so what is the lifted version of this partial Laplacian? Well, the function is twice differentiable and satisfies this kind of property. That is the lifted version of the function on the space of probability measures. Then one has this identity. So here, this is the inner product. This bracket is the inner product in our Hilbert space. So this is the second order Fréchet derivative of the function, which is just a self-adjoint operator acting on this function. So this is an element of T, inner product with this function. And so continuing, if we define the lifted Hamiltonian in this way, right, and then the lifted AJB equation reads like this. So here is the lifted this partial Hessian, lifted Hamiltonian, and in this way we get the equation on the Hilbert space. Whenever I write this means Fréchet derivatives in the Hilbert space. All right, so we'll try to bypass the equation in the Wasserstein space. There is really no good notion of solution there that would give any kind of uniqueness. Whereas for this equation, if H, the original Hamiltonian function, is reasonable, or at least the assumption soon, then this equation is a pretty nice equation, falls into the standard theory of second order viscosity solutions in Hilbert spaces, and it has comparison, unique solution, everything. So this is just the definition of this L-viscosity solution, right? That we say that U is an L-viscosity solution of 1. 1 was the PDE in the Wasserstein space. If this U, which is related to calligraphic U by this relation, is a viscosity subsolution of this lifted equation, this similar with the super solution and solution. So a standard thing. And briefly, let me flash the assumptions. So the function H, which goes from RD PR, I need to take R between 1 and 2, is such that, okay, so this is a kind of a standard assumption, kind of a Lipschitz continuous with some weight depending on the norms of the momentum variables. And then kind of continuous with respect to the x and with respect to the measure variable. The thing is that here dr is the Wasserstein norm in PR. So we need to have some the restriction that r is less than 2. So this is not the Wasserstein 2 distance between measures is forced because we need to get some compactness. There is H has at most quadratic growth. And these, otherwise, the cost function and the initial function are uniform bounded, uniformly continuous in PR. So the main result is this, that So that kappa is the kind of this diffusion coefficient in front of this Wasserstein partial Laplacian. So this result works for both second order and just first order equations. So the functions un, which are the viscosity solutions of the finite dimensional NJV equations. So if un is the viscosity solution of the finite dimensional PDEs, then for every bounded set in P2, we have this uniform local uniform convergence to the function capital script U, which is the script U is the unique viscosity solution on the Wasserstein space. So briefly the kind of idea of the proof. So first one needs to get uniform continuity estimates for UN. So some things are easy. So just looking at trivial comparison functions, one gets a uniform estimate in UN for the infinity norm of UN. So that's very standard. And then the key thing is that one proves the proof that there exists a modulus of continuity rho, such that for every n there is this estimate. So here there is this estimate in this R norm, and R norm is defined by this. So, you know, think of it that if you take the infimum here, or minimum here over all permutations of xi's and yi's, then say xi's, then and this is this would then be the dr R Wasserstein distance between the two empirical measures. So there is this estimate. So this is the kind of where all the difficulty is. So of course I'm not going to say much about this, apart from that the proof is based on the proof of comparison. And the proofs of comparison for these finite D equations and also for the equation limiting equation in the Hilbert space are kind of standard, but the thing is to get the estimate independent of n. So anyway, this is where all the action is, but I cannot really say more here. And the proof actually of this result is much more general, and so we could, for instance, allow an to depend on x, which would be the n by nd by nd matrix composed of n squared block matrices like this. So that would correspond to the case where the there is a common noise in the system, and a of x is the diffusion matrix for the common noise, or we could say also work with an to be just the say identity matrix, or for this reason any matrix non-negative definite symmetric with this kind of restriction on the trace. So for instance, if AN was the identity matrix, that would correspond to the particle systems with independent noises. I probably should have mentioned that this, you know, partial Laplacian that corresponds to the systems with common noise. So the proof of the continuity estimate is very general. I could even, you know, throw more generality here and would still work. However, there is a problem with passing to the limit. So the next step is you extend. So I mean the functions u n are invariant with respect to permutations because of the how the equation look and because of comparison. So one can extend define functions of empirical measures in this way, and then this function script v satisfies the similar estimates. So the similar estimates with the now R Wasserstein distance here. Then you can extend these functions to the whole space, which satisfies the same estimate, and then you look at sets which are, say, sets of measures in PR with bounded second moments, bounded by R. These sets are relatively compact in PR. So up to a subsequence, you can, these functions V, N, converge uniformly on each set like this to a function V, which satisfies the same continuity estimate, and then you convert this limiting function script v, calligraphic v, into a function on the Hilbert space, the lifted function, and then all that remains is to show that this converted function v is a viscosity solution of the lifted equation, because the equation lifted equation has a unique bounded viscosity solution. So then we conclude that the limiting function is the original U, and the whole sequence converges because you can do this same procedure on the on every subsequence. So to prove that this is a viscosity solution, we are in the Hilbert space is a good space, but to pass to the limit in infinite dimensions, it's not enough to have continuity estimates. You need to have uniform convergence. You need some compactness, and contrary to some often popular belief that in infinite dimensional spaces, none of the techniques like method of relaxed limits of bars per term, which are the standard methods in finite D, apply. Very easy to produce counterexamples, and so you really need to have compactness. And in this case, we have the uniform convergence. You take some test function, and you assume that V minus phi has a, you can assume that it's a strict global maximum for some phi in C1-2. And then you compose the function phi with functions like this, functions of making it a function rd to the n. So you take a partition of the unit interval by n intervals of equal length, right? And it's a random variable whose law is the empirical measure of these Dirac deltas. And then because the original function had a strict maximum, then it's easy to see that un minus phi n must have local maxima at points that converge to the original maximum. And then you compute the derivatives, right? So it's easy to compute the derivatives. These are the derivatives with respect to xi. These are the kind of running out of time, so we have to go faster. These are the second derivatives. And then you do some, after some computation, one gets this expression for the trace. And you see that this really resembles the trace term for the limiting thing. And the passing to the limit over here is trivial because, you know, this is a smooth function. Tn converges to T naught. This converges to capital X naught. So passing to the limit in this term is trivial. Passing to the limit with other terms in the nonlinear Hamiltonian requires some technical work, but, you know, not too bad. I want to emphasize here that we're not able to justify this for pass to the limit in the case when An is the identity or identity matrices. So for the case of the independent noises, or not even for the case where we have independent noises and common noise with some diffusion coefficient sigma, and just because of trouble with this second order term. So we were somehow limited. The problem does not seem to be as easy as it may seem. Just an example. So, for instance, if one takes so for simplicity here, I did not include any controls, anything, so this will be just a case of a linear equation. So if we take the particle systems of this form, so here is some kind of a convolution term, a common noise, and then the functions un with some running cost, some initial, in this case, terminal cost, the value functions like this satisfy these finite D PDEs. And what is the Hamiltonian? So An is this matrix with n squared blocks with identities here. And in this case, the Hamiltonian is defined by this nice formula. And if under the assumption that G is a Lipschitz bounded function, it satisfies all the assumptions of this convergence theorem. So such simple cases can be handled. All right, so I still only have 5 minutes, so I need to go a bit faster. I want to emphasize again that we were not able to do this for the other cases. So the next couple of minutes, I want to spend on a little related issue. Is, you know, one, you can also ask, can one define viscosity solutions of the equation in the Wasserstein space without referring to the lifted equation? So for first order case, this you know, you can do it with the notion of like a Wasserstein super differential, sub differential. So is there some kind of equivalent of this? So for this, you know, it was done, for instance, in the paper by Gangbo and S. Well, if you look at kind of Wasserstein second order differential, this is more or less the structure of it. So, you know, first order Wasserstein derivative is a function of mu n of x, right? So if you now look at the expansion of this, you know, if you need to have a term, this term kind of corresponds to the derivative with respect to the, well, call it q variable or x variable. This kind of term, it corresponds to the, think of it as the second derivative with respect to mu variable, right? Because, you know, you need to have the expansion involving both derivatives in q and in mu. So, you know, this is the second order Wasserstein differential, and you know, this is what you would use defining this partial Laplacian, right? Evaluate this at EI, EI. So is there some kind of notion of a parabolic superjet, subjet, maybe superjet, subjet, wrong, is a wrong terminology because usually jet refers to a set such that, you know, for the second derivative, if there is an element in it, then every element bigger than it is also in the jet, which may not be the property here, but you know, one can do something like this by basically restricting elements of jets to derivatives of functions of this form. It's not exactly functions like this. If you leave them, they may not be Frechette differentiable. As Kalper mentioned it in his talk, Gatow differentiable, second order differentiable. So there's more technicalities here, but basically for functions of this form, one can transfer. One can figure out the relationship between the derivatives of the lifted functions and the derivatives of functions in the Wasserstein setup, the Wasserstein space. So if one uses this, one can define this intrinsic viscosity solution. I need to using these elements of the jets. So jets are composed of four elements. There is a time derivative, there is an element for the first derivative, and these two matrices for the involved with the second derivative. Anyway, and one can prove that if U is an L viscosity solution of the equation on the Wasserstein space, meaning in this lifted form, then it's an intrinsic viscosity subsolution, super solution of one. And I want to say that, you know, when kappa is zero, then this is proved in Gangbo to Dorasco, of course, with the definition of solution, which is slightly doesn't have to use the second order jet. And finally, just in what, 1-2 minutes, one can identify the solution in the case of first order convex equations. So if we take the Hamiltonian only depending on x and p for simplicity without the measure variable here, which is coercive, but otherwise, you know, it satisfies the other assumptions, but no other regularity. We take the Lagrangian and then we define the Lagrangian in the Wasserstein space. The candidate for the solution of the equation is this value function in the Wasserstein space. The usual thing, the infimum taken over all pairs where sigma is a path and v is the velocity, meaning that it solves the continuity equation with velocity. The velocity is square integrable. And in this case, the UNs can be written explicitly, right? In this form, these are just absolutely continuous curves. One can prove that the function U bar, the value function is in this case continuous, and that for every mu there is a sequence that converges such that a sequence of empirical measures related to this converges to mu, and one gets this convergence. You know, for the functions un, we have these continuity estimates, so that proves that. And the limit is this value function. It's a kind of a standard result that I would put into the realm of the folklore. However, it's still is not trivial if one wants to do all the details here. You know, it's not trivial to prove the continuity, especially the lower semi-continuity of this. And you know, in many cases, like cases that I guess Alpar talked about, there is an explicit characterization of the optimal trajectory, and in this case, in many cases, the functions un are just restrictions of the value function to the empirical measures. And if this is the case, the results. But you know, for this you need regularity. So here it was not trivial to argue that the value function was continuous. And then, so one can then claim that the value function is the unique viscosity solution of this problem. And I guess that's the end of my talk. Sorry, I ran a bit over time.